Hi everyone, my name is AD and welcome back to ArtSpot, the online version of our free weekly drop-in art making program for children and families at the Tampa Museum of Art. Today we're going to learn about the work of John Baldessari and create something you could call a photo, a collage, a puzzle, conceptual art. We're just going to call it art today. You can find a link in the description to a handout for this project that includes this image of Waterline by John Baldessari. So Waterline is a gelatin silver print and mixed media work. He's basically gluing large photographs to a large piece of paper. It's around 5 feet wide, 7 feet tall, and it was made in 1986 by John Baldessari. So who was John Baldessari? Well, Baldessari was maybe the most influential artist of the last 50 years. He's done experimental work using video, painting, photography, and text. But he's most known for his use of appropriated or found photography. So what is appropriated photography? Simply put, appropriated photography is when you make art with a photo or photos that you found. And Baldessari made Waterline by collaging 6 found photographs into one image, right? These aren't photos that he took, these are images that he found. You can see that each individual photograph depicts a setting or action related to water. But Baldessari isn't really interested in what each individual photograph is about. Instead, he's much more interested in what happens when two different photographs meet one another, right? He's interested in how their meanings change, what new stories happen, and just how you see them differently when you take one photo and put it next to another unrelated photo. Because we're seeing different images one after another in this work, it's natural for us to want to make a kind of story out of it. But Baldessari is careful to maintain a sense of mystery in his art. There's not one specific story that he's trying to create here. One of the things that he does to create the sense of mystery is he crops most of the images. Cropping meaning that he's unexpectedly cutting seemingly important parts of the photograph out, right? Things like the faces of the people, for example. But these are some of the decisions Baldessari is making in putting this work together to ensure that the story is always open to interpretation and different for each viewer. So today we're going to make a work of art inspired by something else that's happening in Waterline, this other interesting thing that's happening, which is that the lines from the edges of the photos line up with each other. You can see it most clearly here where the tops of the surfaces of these bodies of water connect, right? It creates this long continuous line. So this is one of the main things we're going to play around with as we make our collage. We're going to try to find interesting, unexpected connections from one picture to the next. So for today, we're going to need a large piece of paper, glue stick or glue, scissors, any old magazines or books that you have with photos in them, and some markers. To get started, you just want to rip out any photographs that grab your attention. Don't overthink it at all. Anything that looks cool, just rip it out. So then once you have about 10 of those, you want to carefully cut your photographs out right on the edges. Normally when you're making a collage, it's natural to cut out details from each picture, but we want to maintain the overall rectangular format of each of our pictures for this particular project. So make sure you cut right along those edges and make sure you don't have a white border or anything. At this stage too, if you want, you can slice off one of the edges to further crop your images, kind of like in the Baldessari example, to make them more mysterious. Now once you have about 10 of these rectangles of photographic imagery, just start moving them around, playing around with them, and see if you can connect any of the lines from the edges of one photo to the lines of the edges of another photo. After you connect 2 or 3 photos, see if you can connect some more on the other sides of some of those already connected chains of pictures that you've made. And really freely flip them around, turn them upside down, turn them sideways, whatever you need to do to have the sides of your pictures connect. As you watch me finish this up, I want to talk a little bit more about appropriation. So the basic idea behind appropriating photographs is that you can change what a photograph is about simply by putting it in a new place. You don't even have to alter it. Just putting it in an unexpected place is enough to significantly change what that photograph is about. So you can put it next to a new photograph or alter how and where you see it. Just you seeing these photographs on a screen at home is very different from seeing them in a particular place in a book or in a particular location in a museum. So artists have been appropriating photographs for a long time. They're making art with found photos in the early 1900s. Here's one by Hannah Hoog from 1931. And as the century progressed, photography becomes more and more a part of our everyday lives, and every year people are taking more and more photographs. So when you know, how many new photographs do you think are taken every year? It's hard to say exactly how many, obviously, but in 2020, researchers estimate that number is over a trillion photographs a year. So that works out to about 2.7 billion new photographs every day, or about 32,000 new photographs every second. So because there are so many photographs, you know, so many new photographs getting created constantly, artists who appropriate them think of them as a shared public resource. Even if you didn't take a photograph yourself, you can still use it in whatever creative ways you want to. You might already understand this idea if you've ever created your own version of a meme. So after you've connected all of your photos, or you know, 5 or 6 or 7 of your photos, you can then take your markers and start to creatively add tints of colors in the details. You can shade in people's faces or hands, whatever you want to do to kind of further alter the photograph and make it your own. And then finally, the last step is to just glue everything down in place. Be careful when you're adding glue on the back. You can see what I did here. Some of my marker rubbed off on the paper when I put it face down, so I'm gonna grab another photo and cover that mistake. But when you are adding glue to the back, make sure you do that on a separate surface so you don't do what I did and get smears of marker on your paper. Once everything's glued down, take a minute and really look at it and kind of try to make a story for yourself or find unexpected relationships between the photographs that weren't there before. So like in mine, I kind of like mine more than I thought I would. We have this weird sculpture of a bird on the left with these huge legs, right? It looks like a little tiny bird, but it has these really huge, strong legs. And there are these, you know, this photograph of human legs underneath that. And because the edges of the photo line up, you know, it almost looks like those human legs are like the legs of a table that bird is sitting on. And we have this line that cuts across, right, connecting these three photos at the top. And there definitely seems to be some weird relationship between the bird and the woman, like they're mad at each other. Or maybe that woman is reacting to that figure on the right who's metalworking in some way, right? Or she's just simply shielding herself from the sparks that he's creating, right? There's like an interesting tension between those two people too. And then there's the lady at the bottom gesturing with her hand. Remember, I've just moved her down there to cover my marker smudge. But now there's this line coming right up her finger where that shadow is being cast, almost like maybe she's scolding that figure above, right? And then in that piece in the bottom right-hand corner, we have these two figures having a conversation. And it's funny, they're talking in front of this painting of the back of a horse, right? We have all these cropped photographs, and then in one of them is this photo of like a cropped image of a horse, right? The head is kind of weirdly cut off in that painting. So. Yeah, all of the images ended up going together in an unexpected way, right? So I didn't have any set story in my head when I started. I just played around with these materials that I gathered and experimented until something came together on its own, basically. I found Waterline in The Making of a Museum, 100 Years, 100 Works from the Tampa Museum of Art. The Tampa Museum of Art has been around in one form or another for 100 years. In this book, you can read about the history of the Tampa Museum of Art and see photos of the 100 works of art that best represent the museum's collecting history and mission. The collection is unique, with significant holdings of ancient Greek and Roman art, as well as increasing amounts of modern and contemporary art, art that's really old and art that's really new. This selection of 100 works features a wide range of objects that present a unique insight into how the collection and identity of the museum have evolved as it grew from a small local arts organization to the city of Tampa's preeminent museum of art. And copies are available during regular business hours at the museum store. All right, thanks for hanging out. Have a great day, and thank you for learning and making with the Tampa Museum of Art.